thank you so much for joining us for this event. It's fantastic to see this big room with so many people. It really signifies better than anything else we can do or say how much we care about the subjects, the difficult, complex, and hugely important subjects that we're going to be discussing today. We have to do better. We need to continue to hold ourselves to a high standard. We're always very proud. I'm very proud. I tell the world about our success in really having an incredibly diverse student body, and we should be very proud of that. By the way, data show that we have one of the most diverse student bodies in the U.S., and that's a great source of pride. We have numbers also that we need to be very proud of. I am very proud of in terms of graduation performance and so on. And yet, not everything is great at Mason. And when we start digging in a little deeper and spending time with our students, our colleague, Elavine Dura, who, as you know, has been working with me for this year as a presidential fellow. She's been doing a lot of qualitative interviews and assessments and sort of picking the actual experiences of faculty and students in the classroom. She says that we have to do better. I spent some time with groups of concerned students. We have to do better. We have to hold ourselves precisely because we're one of the most diverse universities around, precisely because people look at us as a school that is delivering good results. We owe it to ourselves and to everybody. We have the responsibility to be an example. So we need to hold ourselves to a very high standard and continue to do better in how we make that diversity be what it is, which is a huge asset for all of us. But anyway, because I know there's a big elephant in the room, I'll talk about elephants in the rooms. I know that some of you have had conversations about the announcement last week about, we are going to name one of our schools after Justice Antonin Scalia, a figure that doesn't come naturally as a symbol of diversity and inclusion because of some of the opinions that he expressed in some important cases. And you say, well, does that mean, and I've been asked this question, does that mean that our commitment to diversity and inclusion is somehow weakened, or that we're just giving up on that, or that that's no longer important for us? What I can tell you is absolutely and categorically not. That does not mean our agreement to name the school has absolutely nothing to do with our commitment to diversity and inclusion, which are core values of who we are as a university. And I'll be very honest with you. I personally have significant disagreements with votes cast by Justice Scalia and with opinions expressed about Justice Scalia. And yet I'm perfectly comfortable and very supportive of agreeing to name the school after him. And I can give you very specific details. I do not agree, for example, and by the way, these are my own personal opinions. If we did a survey in this room, I'm sure that we will have an array of opinions. Some people would agree with me, some people wouldn't. But yet, I have issues, for example, with positions that Justice Scalia took on marriage equality. He made a point in his dissenting opinion this last year, saying that this is something to be left to the states, for example. I disagree. I think it's a constitutional right. I think my gay and lesbian colleagues have the same right to marry whoever the hell they choose, just as I did, and that when they do so, we ought to grant them the same rights that society grants me. That's my belief. He argued that that's something that should be legislated by states. There are many other things. He took some very notorious positions on affirmative action or the use of race in admissions. He said that a law school, for example, in the case of a Michigan law school, that race or racial diversity has nothing to do with the ability of a student to perform as a lawyer. I take issue on that. I think that there is a compelling interest by law schools and any academic institution to have a diverse student body. Why? Because in the 21st century, you cannot be educated no matter what background you come from if you are in an environment that does not reflect the various points of view of society. So you would ask, how come if you believe those things, you agreed to name a law school after someone who did not agree with those points? It's because, in my view, it has nothing to do with that. What we're celebrating, what we're not doing is endorsing anybody's ideas. What we're celebrating and honoring is 30 years of a man serving his country at the highest level that anybody can serve the country in the legal profession. This is someone who was appointed by a president of the United States to the highest court of the land, who was, by the way, confirmed by the Senate unanimously when he did, and that for 30 years he earned the respect of his peers for being an extraordinary legal mind and for being what, for producing some of the strongest arguments that forced everybody else in the court to up their game. And by the way, when you look through the list of opinions, I think many of you, we would have differences of opinion on, oh, I agree with that opinion, I agree, or I disagree with that one, or I agree with that vote, or I disagree with that one. Has nothing to do with that. We're not endorsing any of those opinions. That's not what this means. What it means is we're just honoring someone, by the way, a man of Northern Virginia, guy was a good neighbor, a good guy, very engaged guy, who served this country for 30 years at the highest level of our government. That's all we're doing. So anyway, just wanted to clarify that in case, and I'm not implying to convince you. I realize this is an interesting and very difficult and very complex question, and it will continue to trigger lots of conversations and disagreements. I just want you to at least hear from me how I see this decision and what it means, but also link it back to the purpose of today's gathering, which is we hold ourselves to a high standard. We need to be an example of what it means to operate in an incredibly inclusive and diverse academic institution, just like our mission statement says, and I want you to hear it from me. I am as committed as I have always been since I set foot on this campus to that mission. And by the way, let me finish by saying that in the process of agreeing with donors for this particular purpose, we made sure that a chunk of the money is precisely and very directly invested in helping us increase our numbers of diversity and inclusion in the law school. So there are specific aspects of this deal that will have an impact in delivering on our mission. Anyway, with that, sorry about deviating us from the center of this program, which is the incredible lecture we're about to hear and the discussion later, but I thought, again, you probably, given the size of this particular elephant, if unaddressed, it could only perhaps grow bigger and interfere with the work today. I wish this great, productive afternoon, and with that, I leave you with our provost, David Wu. Thank you.
We're not supposed to leave the podium unattended.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Well, first of all, I want to thank all of you to take part in this very important discussion we're going to have this afternoon. And this is certainly a great turnout. And we are anticipating a very dynamic set of discussions. Let me just spend a couple minutes to talk about why we're doing this. And there are, as you know, over the past couple months and maybe even before that, there are various different campus-wide conversations. And some of these are with various different groups of students. And some of these are with different groups of faculty. And so there's one of the sentiment that come from these different groups is that yes, we have a very diverse student population, and but in many ways that some of our classrooms and some of our learning environment may not be viewed as the most welcoming to students from all different kind of backgrounds. So that kind of raised the issue of whether us as educational institution, are we ready to really take the full advantage of this diverse student population, and are our faculty really fully prepared to really play their role? So in many ways, we want to really tool our faculty and our staff with the capacity, with the tools, that you will be able to address some of these issues, and some of you may feel somewhat unprepared, or some of these topics may be considered controversial in your mind. And so we really want to host these. This is a series of different events that we are doing, and this is the first one. I'm looking at Kim Eby and Rose, who has been instrumental in putting this together. So really the goal is to provide you with the tools and the environment to have these dialogues so that you're prepared to have these conversations with our students and about things such as racism, things such as diversity and inclusion and so on. So today the program in many ways is to allow us to do this, and we're gonna do this throughout the academic year, and we'll continue. This is not a sort of one-shot deal, as you know, and we need to basically continue to do this. And another very important aspect of this is to deepen the dialogue around the experience and needs of our students. And I remember in one of the meetings with a group of students who are concerned about our environment, and they asked the question, very simply stated, they said, yes, we are very diverse, but are we inclusive? I think that's a very simple and straightforward question, and that kind of really got me in thinking, right? And sort of having a diverse population is a fact, but are we creating an environment that is truly inclusive? And I think that's in many ways what we're trying to address here, and that's really a greater challenge that we all face as a community. So we are also working to develop a plan to close the gap between the diversity of our student body as well as our faculty population, our staff population. As you know, our student population is among the most diverse in the country. We can't quite say the same about our faculty population or for that matter our staff population. And we are certainly taking steps to address that issue and working with Julian Williams' office. This will take time. However, we're committed. We're committed to close that gap between the diversity of our student body and the diversity of our faculty and the staff. So this effort in terms of increasing our faculty diversity and increasing the cultural proficiency of our faculty and our staff, and these are significant effort, and we have some senior officers of the university that's leading this effort. And of course, I myself as a provost, I'm fully committed to this cause. And we also have some senior leaders, such as Julian Williams, and he's the Vice President for Compliance, Diversity, and Ethics. Kim Eby, as I mentioned, and she is the Associate Provost for Faculty Development and Enrichment. And Rose Pascara, our Vice President for University Life. So these are really the senior leaders in the university that will be leading this charge. I also want to recognize and especially thank the planning committee that put this event together. And as I said, this is one of a series, and so they will be rewarded with a lot more work if this is successful, and looks like it is. So I appreciate the effort from Laura Bell, who has really put behind a lot of this effort. Especially on the logistics, and the Professor Wendy Emanuel Scott, she's the director of African and African American Studies. Angie Hattery, director of Women and Gender Studies. Rita Chan, professor of the College of Education and Human Development. Alavi Nandura. And she's, as the president just mentioned, the presidential fellow for diversity and inclusion. Rodney Hobson, professor of the College of Education and Human Development. Joa Creer, an associate dean of University Life. And Geraldine Mobley, and compliance, diversity, and ethics. And I'm looking at my list. I'm sure I'm still missing some of the people who has been putting in a lot of effort to put this event together, and I want to thank you all. And we have really considerable expertise among our faculty and staff in research, in teaching, in scholarship, in providing very direct services to our students. And that's really the great thing about Mason. that we have such deep expertise in various different disciplines and expertise that we can draw from for events and initiatives such as this. And we will continue to highlight expertise, and we will further increase our effort. And we want, as I mentioned, every faculty and student staff on this campus to feel welcome and respected in this amazing learning environment. And we expect to learn much more from this campus-wide climate survey, which will be commenced this fall. And so not only in terms of hearing anecdotes and opinions, we want to do a campus-wide survey to help us to better understand how people have been experiencing and so on. So thank you again for taking part in playing a part in the beginning of this series, and I want to count on your support and your help for the remainder of the series, which is going to come, and stay tuned. And now I want to introduce Dr. Wendy Emanuel Scott, and who will introduce our keynote speaker. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Yes, energy is always beautiful. So I have the honor of introducing our keynote speaker this afternoon. But before I do so, I want to let you know that you are encouraged to tweet hashtag DoWhatMatters@Mason and hashtag Tricia Rose. So, Dr. Tricia Rose. Dr. Rose graduated from Yale University, where she received a BA in sociology and then earned her PhD from Brown University in American Studies. She has taught at NYU, UC Santa Cruz, and is currently Professor of Africana Studies and Director of the Center for the Study of Race and Ethnicity in America at Brown University. Professor Rose is internationally respected as a scholar of post-civil rights era Black U.S. culture, popular music, social issues, gender, and sexuality. She is most well known for her groundbreaking book on the emergence of hip-hop culture, Black noise, rap music, and Black culture in contemporary America. Black Noise is considered the foundational text in the study of hip-hop, and the text itself has redefined the entire field. In 2003, Dr. Rose published a rare oral narrative history of Black women's sexual life stories called Longing to Tell. Black women talk about sexuality and intimacy. In the book, she explores the radical power of love, inclusion, and creativity. Then, in 2008, Dr. Rose returned to the theme of hip-hop with her book, The Hip-Hop Wars, What We Talk About When We Talk About Hip-Hop and Why It Matters. So Dr. Tricia Rose engages in courageous conversations, workshops with academic and general audiences on a wide range of issues concerning race and racism in America, mass media, structural inequality, popular culture, art, and social justice. She has been featured on MSNBC, CNN, NPR, Time Magazine, Essence, the New York Times, so yes, she is fierce. So because Mason believes in excellence, then it is no surprise that this is not the first time we invited Dr. Rose to Mason. In 2005, we invited her to campus to speak on intimate justice. She discussed issues of interracial dating, color hierarchies, and the double standards for Black women. Then again in 2015, Dr. Rose was our Black Heritage Month keynote speaker. She discussed tools necessary to build mutually respectful, informed, compassionate, and supportive relationships among marginalized communities on college campuses. So Dr. Rose is no stranger to George Mason University. And I often tell folks when they visit my home for the first time, okay, you're a guest. And then the second time they come to my home, I always tell them, okay, now you're a friend. And the third time they come to my home, I always consider them family. So Dr. Rose, we consider you family. So welcome back. We are ready to be challenged, unsettled, inspired, to do the important work, transformative work, necessary to create a more inclusive campus for all. Welcome, Dr. Rose.
Thank you. Wow, what a wonderful introduction. I gave her a family hug, because now, you know, if we're family, you got a hug. That's my first rule. So I got this very cool, you know, clip-on mic, so I'm going to remove this one, because let me make sure it works. Can you still hear me? Okay, excellent. So this way, I don't know, I don't think I need both of these, do I, huh? Okay. Is that okay? All right, we can see. Oh, excellent. Wendy, thank you. That was just fabulous. I mean, just super fabulous. I'm thinking about how to bottle that and bring it, you know. I think that was the most powerful description and inflection of the word international that I've ever heard. I was like, yes, exactly. Normally I'm just like, I'm like, right, who's she talking about? Amazing. It's totally an honor to be here again. I was just telling some of my seatmates that I've been here, I think at least three times. I think there might have been some earlier, but we're all too young to know anything about that. But I think it's even goes back longer. It's a lovely campus with smart, amazing students and faculty, so I'm always happy to come back. This topic in this context is especially a subject that's close to my heart, but very powerful and important right now. Figuring out how to deal with what we've created at this moment is a special challenge. And so I'm really grateful to be asked to come here as you embark on this, what will certainly be a long and complex set of conversations, in a year where many campuses are finding themselves unsettled, brought up, sort of, you know, challenged, particularly campuses that think that they were already doing whatever it was they were supposed to be doing. Right, some campuses already know they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. They're just laying low right now. But you find campuses like Brown, right? Campuses like Oberlin. I mean, how much more crunchy can you get? You know, it's just such a fabulously, you know, liberal place. How can it be, right? It's sort of it's Berkeley, right? So it's an important sort of moment that I want all of you who are over 25 or over 30 to really be grateful to your students for bringing. And I really genuinely mean that we owe our students a debt of gratitude. I mean, they've called us to conscience. And frankly, a lot of people had sort of fallen asleep at the wheel. A lot of institutions had fallen asleep at the wheel and sort of took the road that if they say it, it must be so, right? That is, if I say I'm for diversity, or I say I'm for equality, or I say I'm for justice, I say I'm for an equal society, I say I'm for meritocracy, I say I'm for fill in the blank terrific value, right? Therefore, it must be so, because everybody I know feels that way. I feel that way, you feel that way, you feel that way, you feel that way. So then it's so. Not exactly. And so that next set of hard questions, which is, okay, these are our so-called values, well, how actually do they play out? And what does it really look like? And what are people experiencing? And what are the hard and really complex ways in which we're embedded in a social world, much bigger than the campus we're in, much bigger than the state we're in, and that we can't pretend, and I say this, you know, as an academic for longer than I'll discuss quite yet, but, you know, we can't pretend that we live outside of the world, right? We don't live outside of the world. We live in the world. We come and bring the world with us when we come to our campuses. So I'm really grateful for this opportunity, and I'm especially grateful to the planners who planned really very, very intently and thoughtfully and carefully. And I say that not just being kind, although I try to be kind, but because I've done enough of this to know what happens when it's not planned that way. And you're very fortunate to have terrific people who've put this together. It's really very, very, very well done. But before I get into any sort of facts and data and arguments and my positions, I just want to say, you know, this is very emotionally difficult work. It's very challenging work. It's intellectually challenging, but the idea that those two things are separate has been part of the fiction of modern Western ideology for a long time, right? The head and the heart are always tethered to one another. It's challenging on both levels. I've been teaching about race in African American studies, you know, in American society, you know, for 20 plus years. And it's never been an easy task to really confront the circumstances that we've created in this world. Just the United States, let's just, for this moment, we're just going to speak about the US, although, of course, this has just massive global repercussions. But doing this work in the classroom and in public and other places has been simultaneously exhilarating and very difficult. And I say both of those things completely equally, right? I mean, there are days when I'm like, I am not doing this one more day. Today was the last day. That's it. And my husband's like, okay. He's used to hearing me. He's like, okay. Tomorrow, okay, so here's how I'm going to tackle why that didn't work yesterday the way I was hoping, right? So equally exhilarating and difficult. Why is it difficult? Of course, you have to manage a range of beliefs, many of which, you know, from my perspective, are ill-informed, right? Not all, but many of which. And frankly, a lack of knowledge that the last 30 years has produced. We've produced an illiteracy, and I'm going to come back to this. We've produced an illiteracy about race that makes us, in some ways, less equipped than people 30 years ago to talk about certain issues based on how we've chosen to frame the successes we've had. So the range of beliefs, the intensity, the aggression of the disagreements in the public arena, the callousness about the suffering of vulnerable people that's become quite politically acceptable, really on all political sides, but particularly from some perspectives. And so it's difficult to manage that. It's very difficult to keep everyone connected. A lot of these issues divide people, even if they don't say so on the surface. But most importantly is the biggest challenge, which is the most important thing, which if I don't do, you should call me on any moment, and that is to not be honest. You really have to be honest about the real situation. And you have to be honest about what you think about it, but also what the data means, and avoid all kinds of euphemisms, not in the interest of separation, but actually in the interest of connection. I have found literally over 20 years that the more honest I am, the more I treat everybody with as much respect as I can possibly galvan, I mean 18-year-olds all the way up to, you know, grandparents, that the more I'm honest about what I think the situation is, the more I listen, of course, but the more I don't hold back just to make people feel comfortable, but I hold on to everybody at the same time, the better off we all are, the further along we go, the much greater connections we have when we get to the end of 12 weeks, 14 weeks, whatever the time frame is. So what's been totally exhilarating is the dramatic transformation and the growth and understanding that teaching about race and inequality, when it's done in an honest way, when it's done in a, you know, tackling difficult subjects with painful circumstances, but with intentions toward a better, just world, not an intention toward simply making us think only about what's happened, but with using all of that information to harness in a future that we're seeking. That's what makes it exhilarating. I've never, never not double negative African-American studies. I've never not been completely transformed by my students' transformation. Always. Never one semester. That's why I try to give up on a Tuesday. That's why on a Thursday I'm back doing it again, because I happened to remember on Wednesday while I was all depressed about Tuesday that last week was amazing. And I think I want to have that experience again. So I say this not just to tell you my own trajectory, but because I want you to understand this is a long distance run. And it requires a tremendous amount of honesty and hopefulness, but also an understanding that there is tremendous connection in a truly just context. And to get there, you have to be able to go through some rocky spaces. And so, you know, that's without a doubt what I'm sure many of you have already done in your lives and your careers, and what many of you will do as you take this on campus. I studied the post-civil rights era, which pretty much means increasingly everything past 1975 or 80, which is getting to be a bit bigger. And as time moves along, I'm going to have to put an end cap on that. Because, you know, every year is a new year to figure out. But there's a particular challenge to thinking about and examining race and racial inequality and how it happens in the post-civil rights era. It's a particular challenge. It's very different than most of the rest of U.S. history. In fact, all of the rest of U.S. history around the question of race. That challenge is not only confronting the history itself, but confronting it inside of the relationship we think we have to that history. So prior to 1975, prior to many of the glorious successes of the civil rights movement, a certain kind of, you know, what would today be considered a vicious kind of white superiority or white supremacy was the normal public discourse in American society. It was not some marginal thing. It wasn't some underground private social club. It was the dominant political, intellectual, academic, social ideology of the land. It doesn't mean everybody agreed with it. It doesn't mean that there weren't challenges to it, but it does mean that it was not in any way marginal. Much of that ideology included very explicit, what we would consider today hate speech, right? The tremendous successes of the civil rights movement, and not just that moment, but in particular that moment, ushered in a new era in which we no longer have as acceptable public speech to really speak from dramatic racialized hatred as a predominant ideology, either of the state or through everyday practice. We have laws that in the post-civil rights era outlaw discrimination based on a variety of categories: race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender, etc. This was profound. It was significant. We all know, I'm certain, the basics of this history. But what's happened in the post-civil rights era that we've not spent enough talking about is what structurally actually changed. Did our beliefs and our new laws and our new sense of self match up with our practices? And those, particularly sociologists and social scientists in the room and African-American studies scholars and Latino studies scholars, would most likely simply say, if they study these issues, that no, the practices have not matched up with the rhetoric and the ideology. So what we have is a profound gap that got filled by a set of ideas that I want to talk about. So the gap that got created here was a belief in egalitarianism, a public expression of racial equality. Over 95% of whites, if asked, do they believe in racial equality, will say yes. Today, that's not the case 60 years ago, say, for example, not even close. So there's a tremendous set of beliefs that we should all want, we should be excited about that. That's a great thing. But when we ask about existing structural inequalities and what people are willing to do to actually change those structural inequities, you get a much different response. You get lots of claims that anything designed like affirmative action, for example, or anything else that's in that general category, would constitute special favors and thereby produce advantages and are not actually kosher, not acceptable, not considered favored. And so you have this idea that because we largely believe that egalitarianism is the right way to be, but we're confronted with structural conditions that don't match that belief, we have a fork in the road, right? Either we're going to figure out how to address that, or we're going to continually reproduce it, and we're going to find that the gap between what we think and what we have will widen. And that's pretty much what's happened since the mid-1970s. that gap has actually either remained the same or widened. There is, of course, a much bigger black middle class than there was in 1975, but on every other marker, and I'm going to give you some numbers in a moment, the numbers are staggeringly either static or worse. And that context has not been adequately brought into the mainstream rhetoric about race. So, for example, we love, if you follow Hollywood films, you would think that everything that went wrong on football teams in the 1950s has been done in the Hollywood arena. I think there must be 20 movies about integrating a high school football team, right? And I swear that must have been the only place things went wrong, you know? I don't know why the football team is the team that is, why isn't basketball or some other sport, but it's the football team, and it's either the coach who was courageous or one player who was courageous, some other player from another town. But whatever happens, it's 1950, fill in the blank. And eventually, you know, we triumph over the kind of racism that existed then. Don't get me wrong, I'm very happy. I'm from New York City. I'm all about triumphing over 1950s racism. Like, I don't want to revisit it. I'm not certainly calling for it. But we tell ourselves this story, and we walk away very self-congratulatory about, you know, thank goodness, we sure did. Phew, that was terrible. Back then, that was horrible. I don't know what they were thinking. Right? There's a kind of cult, which we should be grateful, right? But it doesn't help us raise the question, well, what does structural racism look like today? There's no longer Jim Crow or Jane Crow in the official law of the land. But if you follow the expansion and the particular direction of the emergence of the prison industrial complex, many have argued it is the new Jim Crow. Michelle Alexander's argument, people have critiqued it. There are legitimate critiques of it. But the continuities of the criminalization of black bodies, particularly starting right after slavery and moving immediately up to the present, is an unbroken chain. And the impact of mass incarceration on the economic, social, political, psychological, physical health and communities of people of color and poor people, 80% of people in prison do not have a high school diploma. So this is a class issue as well as a race and ethnicity issue. These communities and constituencies are not thought of as continuing a history of structural racism, when in fact that's what it is in very clear terms. In fact, there's been some recent evidence to show that the war on drugs was actually intentionally planned with this in mind. It's relatively new, so I won't treat it as an absolute fact yet, but it does look like there was strategic intentionality, not randomness. So the post-civil rights era is an era in which we focus on what scholars and sociologists like Patricia Hill Collins would call old racism when we're unable to see what racism looks like in this new era, which she calls new racism. So the new racial beliefs that take place after 1975 are actually quite formidable because they recruit, and this is the most important thing, if nothing else sticks in your brain, which would happen to me, I'd be like, I had lunch, I'm sleepy. If nothing else stays in your brain today, it is this, that the newer forms of new racism are formidable obstacles to racial equality because they recruit and rely on our belief system of equality and egalitarianism. Old racism relied on the opposite. There are hierarchies. Some people are just better than other people. New racism relies on the idea of egalitarianism and equality as if we are already at an equal state, and since that is so, which it's not, but this is the logic, since that is so, any effort to redress inequality is racism itself. You guys follow me? It's okay, because it's so it's because it's a little bit confusing to me when I think about it. I'm like, really? But it is quite a coherent logic. So these obstacles to racial equality rely on and recruit our best values. And this is one of the things that really does upset me about it, because it takes the things that we share that are that's good and presses it into, I would argue, very destructive service. So I want to focus on three sort of areas where this happens and how it happens a little bit, and then focus in on higher education since we're here in a higher educational setting. The first main way that post-civil rights era racism happens is through the ideology of colorblindness, which is what I've just hinted at. There's a long, fascinating version of another talk that I could give but can't because I'm giving this one, but in which I talk about how this idea of colorblindness came to mean what it means. It's the very short version is a manipulation of a phrase in Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech to actually change the phrase, the content of don't judge people by the content of their, judge people by the content of their character, not by the color of their skin, which gets translated particularly by conservative ideologues, but mostly Ronald Reagan in the late 1970s, early 80s, to equal colorblindness. That is to say that you're not to see or acknowledge or notice color in any way. Once you do that, you actually reinscribe racism and racial categorization, and in so doing, you yourself are being a racist. This is not what Martin King meant. We can discuss that another day. But what's important about it is that it ushered in an entire way of thinking that to talk about race, to talk about racial inequality, to measure race, to have race on the census, to examine legacies of structural discrimination based on race would in fact create racism. And that to say that you do not see race is the only way to break free. Now, in some abstract theoretical world, I can imagine how an argument like this might make some sense. That is to say, if I were to import racial categories today into a world in which they didn't exist, that would make some sense to me, because I would be importing racial categories into today's situation. But seeing as that's not the case, and seeing as that in its place is a system that is very similar to a racial caste system for the vast majority of black and brown people, how can it possibly be that figuring that out is making it happen? Let me just give you some stats that if we wouldn't know if we had followed colorblind, if we had done colorblind sociology, we would not know that black wealth and white wealth, that there is well over a 15 to 20 time fold degree of difference in wealth. For every average white family, you have over $120,000 in assets beyond debt. That number for black people is something like $5,000. That's not a gap of, you know, working hard. That's a gap of inheritance, of legacy, of histories of racial privilege, of banking and lending discrimination, of housing discrimination, of job discrimination. We wouldn't even know that if we didn't have the ability to figure out how race was operating as a category. You see the point. We actually wouldn't have any ways to see how that might be the case. Wealth is just one category. We can talk about others. But colorblindness implies that racial equality will be achieved with as long as there is no race talk, that you can't have productive race talk toward justice. It rejects racial categorizations. It claims, actually, for the most part, that because the law changed, society itself was fundamentally different. And therefore, you should not, in fact, understand race as an existing factor today. That's how we got to post-race. We went from colorblindness to post-race. Obama's presidency in particular ushered in this new version of colorblindness, which was post-race. Wolf Blitzer, my favorite moment, the night that Obama was elected the first time, is, you know, very excited. If you ever pull this up on YouTube, I mean, he's just like out of his seat. He's almost like, you know, elevating out of his seat. And he's like, you know, he says, I just, you know, this is amazing. We elected the first black president of the United States. This is amazing, amazing. And I didn't even notice that he was black. I was so confused. I thought, well, how do you know he's the first black president then? This is just totally illogical. Like, it should sound, you should stop and say to yourself, okay, I must mean something I'm not quite conveying here. But it made perfect sense to everybody, right? To say that somehow you didn't notice that he was black, but that you're really excited. Why? Because he is black. Now, this sounds silly, but it's actually important because it speaks to what I just said before about the disabling language that we've created in this era. So that we can at once acknowledge that it's a landmark for him to be president because of a history of racism. Otherwise, it wouldn't be particularly interesting, right? If there's no history of racism, he'd be just another brother in the office, right? It's women would be the category. We haven't figured that one out yet. But to say that it's this amazing achievement because of these circumstances that we don't mention over here, then we can get all excited about transcending it, but then we gotta import a colorblind framework for appreciating a racial achievement against the odds. This is a dilemma of much diversity work today. This problem is not something I'm simply saying as a humorous example. It captures us because we end up, for example, retreating from the legacy of harm. Listen to me carefully here. We retreat from addressing a legacy of harm to the sort of social value of having a diverse group of people. Both things are valuable and important, but one does not replace the other. You can't say that if you have lived in a society in which some group of people, whomever they may be, have been systematically undermined and their value and stability and communities have been economically eviscerated, socially destroyed, policed violently, and then say that the only thing we're going to do in response to that is say that they should come and be able to contribute to a wide range of experiences on a campus or in a job or at another location, that's dishonest. See, to me, that's not being honest. This is my point of view. It's being dishonest. It means that there is a debt to be paid. Now, the question is, how do we pay that debt? How do we acknowledge that if we're going to create deeply unlevel playing fields, that we can't then tell everybody involved, oh, by the way, we're a meritocracy? Because that will produce the inequality that we start with. So we have to be honest about that legacy at the same time as we have to recognize that the conditions may not be perfect to fully address and redress those conditions. But we can't lie about what they are and how they play out. We don't have unequal school systems randomly. Those school systems are unequal structurally and racially and class-based because we insist on funding schools through public taxes in taxes on our houses and property. So property taxes fund public schools. And if you fund public schools through property taxes in a society that has for solid 300 years created a deep economic wealth gap due to home ownership values based on race, which I can give you all kinds of citations for, you're creating a structural form of educational inequality. But when those schools have unequal outcomes, your explanation is not where are the experienced teachers going, what are the conditions of the neighborhood, what are the economic circumstances and resources that families do and don't have? Are they segregated? Are the problems being consolidated for various kinds of racialized outcomes? And how are property taxes creating the circumstances? If we don't answer that way, we're being dishonest. If we say kids don't like it, they need to dress better, they're not interested in school, they need to pull up their pants, they may need to pull up their pants. I have to say, I like pants that are on. However, that will not create an equal school environment. Because if you were of a certain age, there were things we were supposed to do as well. Our bell bottoms were too wide. You know you're out there. Your afro was too big, right? And you weren't interested in school because your afro was too big, right? Now it's something else. But this kind of behavioralist frame obscures the structural conditions that create the kinds of racial inequities that we're dealing with. So colorblindness depends on the idea that we've overcome structural racism and allows us to import the idea of meritocracy on top of structural inequity. So we import the idea of meritocracy on top of structural inequity. There are many aspects of society, but in the five major ones that shape our lives, wealth, education, criminal justice, media and, education. You find massive disparities that are reproduced by policy practice and behavior. in all of those aspects, and they work collectively to create tremendous gaps that can only be understood when you take these aspects of society into account relationally, so that you can't look at criminal justice alone. You have to look at it in relationship to schools, in relationship to wealth, in relationship to other aspects of society. And when those things come together in your analysis, it's very easy to see how these gaps are actually widening and maintaining themselves despite our belief in racial equality. You see the gap. This is the post-civil rights era world that we have some work to do in. So when I think about the students and what they've all been asking for, you know, a lot of, Brown had a lot of discussions about this, and I've been reading around the campus, and I've heard and spoken to some people here about what the students have asked for, and they're very similar. They're very, very similar, and they relate to this problem that I'm talking about. Some of the requests, and I'm sure we'll talk about this more in the Q&A, but some of the requests involve concerns about public safety. That is to say, our campuses, this isn't just George Mason here, I'm speaking very broadly, to what degree are campus police treating young students of color on the campus as interlopers automatically? And or they're policed more, asked for ID more, treated differently. And this, again, I hear this across the country. This isn't one rogue public safety officer, you know, gone off the deep end or something. This is something much more systemic about the who we are and who belongs and perceptions of belonging and our national responsibility to deal with the question of how police black and brown communities. Another issue is the question of mentorship, the question of hiring and having a diverse faculty. Most higher educational institutions, particularly historically underrepresented group faculty, that's, you know, mostly black and Latino, but there are others and Native Americans who fit into that group primarily in the way it's been legally defined. Those groups are terribly underrepresented. Why is that? I know at my own school the numbers are not that great. Your numbers are what they are. They're about, say, 3%, say, people of African descent. How does that happen? Native Americans point two. I'd like to meet that 0.2 person. That's a joke. Latinos, 2%. So we're under, you know, just under 5%. So how does that happen? Is it that people are holding people back and saying horrible things and working, you know, like it's 19, like we're back on the football team in the 50s? No, we're not back on the football team in the 50s. It's a whole new process. Well, first of all, this is really where it really starts mattering. The pipeline for higher education begins where? Elementary school. The pipeline for PhDs also begins in elementary school. And if you think you're losing people through high school, imagine who you're losing through college and then losing through PhD work. What are the mechanisms for that loss? I can talk a lot about that. I'm going to get through the arc of this. We can come back in the Q&A if you want more details. But this is extremely important because the lack of diversity isn't just a number that we have to fix. It's the result of a set of practices that are implicit, explicit, that predate and any moment that before George Mason comes into the picture or before Brown comes into the picture, before any school comes into the picture. There are all of these forces that create a set of conditions that marginalize and make much less accessible certain levels of education to certain groups of people. That context changes the pipeline, right? People call it a pipeline, I call it a straw when you get to higher education and when you get to PhD level work. The number of black women with PhDs in the country is 0.3%. Just 0.3. So you just call me 0.3, you call her 0.3, you know. That's our new nickname, we're gonna start a group. 0.3. Now, you can't diversify of every campus on the country, right, with 0.3%. A sister can only work in one place at one time. Now, sisters do hold down 2, 3, and 4 jobs, just because that's how it plays out. You think I'm kidding? I'm really not kidding. But it's okay to laugh because it's a joke and I'm not kidding, all at the same time. Sisters do hold down many jobs, but even we can't diversify the whole country at 0.3%. You're just going to need more PhDs. You're going to have to expand the pipeline. So So in other words, the problems that your campus might be trying to solve have to be tethered to a much broader understanding about the social conditions and circumstances that we inherit, good intentions notwithstanding. We're not just implicated in it, we're also creating it in the way we mentor, in the way that we teach our undergraduates, and we're also victims of it because this circumstance comes to us no matter what a good job we might be doing. So it's both and. Many of the other concerns that students have asked about have to do with grading and expectations and racial experiences and ethnic and gender and sexuality experiences in the classroom. There's also an absence of understanding how racial ideology is playing out. So, for example, many the issues of colorblindness and meritocracy come up in the classroom, and there is an inadequate sort of intellectual and academic understanding of the issues to really address it. So let me just spend a couple of more minutes on the hiring piece and on how this happens very specifically, how meritocracy happens under structural racism. So I planned this one out partly because I've done enough service work at my various institutions over the years to see how this plays out. But I also know that many of you are faculty. How many people in here are faculty? Because I got a number count. Okay, that's pretty. How many are staff? And how many are students? Okay, wow, it's pretty almost equal. Maybe not exactly equal, but pretty close to all three. That's great. So I'll give this quick hiring example because the numbers I had were way like 3-1 faculty, and I thought that would be most useful. So if we get to the Q&A and you want some example from another context, happy to give it. Happy to give anything you want that I have. But let me just give you an example of how this meritocracy happens under structural racism and how we create the conditions that we say we don't want. And I mean this with really a tremendously open heart because I've never been on a search committee with people who I don't like, who I don't have lunch with, who I don't get along with. It's like, this is not like a matter of the kinds of things we like to think of it, like some guys on the committee just going out of his way to undermine the process. Half of what happens goes on so deeply, not only unconsciously, but just not even aware of the mechanisms that are in play that might be contributing. So I offer this really in the spirit of that. So the first thing we do is we talk about excellence, not to dismiss the importance of excellence. But the first thing we do is we talk about hiring the best candidate. Okay, now we can't argue against the best candidate, right? But when you ask people to unpack what they mean by excellence, the descriptions do not get terribly deep. It's like, they're really, really good. Well, what do you mean? They're just great. What do you mean? They're like the best in the bunch. Okay, well, how? Okay, now there are things like peer reviews and publications, but even those things have everything to do with what the subjects are and how those subjects and whether or not certain peer review journals value those subjects, because it's all about self-review. But let's take the scholarship off the table. Let's just say everybody has published at the same level. One of the ways that this process of hiring actually reproduces exclusions unintentionally, perhaps, I can't speak to intentions, but I can say that they happen regardless, is that we say we have diversity initiatives, we say we want to have an affirmative action officer on the committee whose job it is to make sure that the pool is diverse. Have you all have this kind of situation here, where you have someone whose job it is to make sure the pool of applicants is diverse? Is that a yes? Okay, and you don't? Okay, well, that would be a good idea if you don't. Anyway, that's just for a note to self. This is a little check you might have. So you say, how do you guarantee a pool? So you advertise widely. Okay, so you advertise widely. Well, what's widely? Where are the scholars of color who might be in a given discipline? So the Sociology Association or the American Studies Association, there might be, and there are often, wings of research for gender, for sexuality, for race, that if you want to target scholars in those areas, that's where you would go. And I've been on committees and had this same discussion. We want to get and make sure there are women in this search for women's history. Good idea. So how are you going to go about doing that? Well, you want to go to the Women's History Association, make sure that things are not just the AHA, right? So the first thing is where. Then there's the language in the job description. And this is very important. If you're assuming a meritocracy and a colorblind society, then you're going to have very neutral language that looks like it's inviting everybody equally. You see where I'm going with the problem of colorblindness and meritocracy under conditions of significant marginality and exclusion? You end up reproducing those who hear themselves hailed from the beginning. Neutral speech for those who feel that things are fine for them is an invitation. Neutral speech for people of color and women, especially in the sciences, is called, we're not really talking to you. This is the truth. There's plenty of studies on this, about how people respond to the language, what they think it means. So creating a framework of what looks like complete equality when the conditions are not equal actually generates unequal outcomes. Now, if you get applicants, you find, for example, there's very likely to be situations where, not just where the ads are posted, not how they're written, but then there's scholarly networks. I get the job ad, I send it out to my networks. If I'm not on that committee, and I happen to study race and ethnicity, that means candidates in said field who study race and ethnicity are less likely to hear about this job personally. So social networks are incredibly important for all jobs. I mean, there are many of you I know study this, I'm sure, outside of the academy, but it's equally, if not more important, inside the academy. So these social networks are extremely important for creating recognition and creating opportunities. And then there's reliance on credentializing. Who's got the best degree? As you well know, there are brilliant people everywhere with all kinds of degrees. Some of my most brilliant friends have never seen the Ivy League. And yet, we often import a very narrow idea about credentials as the equivalent of scholarly value and of teaching value. And this is extremely important, especially because women in the sciences and people of color, first-gen students, poor people, poor students, students who come from working-class backgrounds, often have what you call a late peak, because they're starting in the building next door, okay? This is the starting line. They're actually starting over here. So yeah, they're gonna be late getting here. They're like, are we here? Are we doing it yet? Are we ready? Everybody's like up there going, where have you been? I'm like, well, I was out back there trying to get over here. So notorious late arc. That doesn't mean they're not brilliant, doesn't mean they're not gonna be brilliant, doesn't mean they're not gonna be the best of the bunch at some point. But if you're looking at junior faculty straight out of the gate, for example, you find gaps in preparedness sometimes, partly because of the pipeline, partly because of the previous gaps, and partly because of the other hurdles that have to be overcome. So these are loosely called headwinds. When you think about these factors, they play a tremendous role in what people look like on this so-called level playing field called the short list campus visit. And then there are all these social codes. I've interviewed several of very distinguished black scientists who talk about it's almost like the proverbial who plays golf situation. Like, what sports do you play? What slang do you use? What do you do in your free time? And one very distinguished black astrophysicist, I don't mess with things like that. It's too complicated. It'll never happen. I'm not sure what that means. I think he's a planet hunter. He said, you know, I didn't play Frisbee, and I couldn't have a social experience because I didn't play Frisbee. You know, everybody played Frisbee for some reason. They weren't like, why don't I play Frisbee? He's like, man, I don't play Frisbee. You know, I mean, I just don't. So it was a kind of sort of inside-outside. Again, this isn't about intention. It's about the way these cultural networks create connections. They create spaces for socialization. They create opportunities. And then there's, of course, all of the work of implicit bias and the deep lack of awareness about how that happens and how it plays a role. And then here comes colorblindness, because now if you try to talk about this in a search context, you get the colorblindness problem. You can't even really talk about it. So these are not random elements of this process. I've experienced every single one of these as a person on a search committee. I know many people who have. I've read numerous articles on this process. It's extremely common. This is with good intentions and a good effort. Now, I mention this because in order to actually achieve the kinds of goals that your students here, my students at home, other people's students, our own faculty and staff are actually asking for is going to require that kind of granularity. It's not going to work inside of the context of simply saying, you know, hey, you know, we believe in diversity. Yes, we believe in diversity. We believe in eventually having a meritocracy, and right now we're working toward it. We're trying to live up to it as best we can, but we're not, we actually don't have one. We can't have a meritocracy inside of structural constraints of this magnitude. It's, they're oxymoronic. And yet we function as if we already have it. And I just want to poke for a minute on this phrase, inclusive excellence. I mentioned this on the phone when I spoke to the organizer, so they shouldn't be surprised that I'll say it again, so I'm not, you know, doing some sort of aha, negative aha, as opposed to Oprah's aha. But inclusive excellence is well-meaning, but it has the potential to be understood as a dog whistle. So let me explain what I mean. So of course, look, all schools are about excellence. Have you ever heard of a school say, hey, we want inclusive mediocrity? Or we want discriminatory mediocrity? Or, you know, we're just a decent school. We're like, meh, we do all right. We'll take that. Who says that? I mean, I've never heard a school say that in all my years. Everybody's striving for excellence. So why do we add, when we're doing inclusive work, inclusive excellence? What do we mean? Is there something inherently contradictory about inclusion and excellence? Are we implying that inclusion lowers standards? Which is the claim that many people who fought all aspects of affirmative action made. They used a merit answer to a structural discrimination question. So when I hear inclusive excellence, and I've said this at my own institution around using, you know, when we're talking about inclusion or diversity, and then we're throwing in this word excellence, we have to ask, be very thoughtful about how and why we're using it and when we're using it, and do we need it? I mean, obviously, it should be obvious that everything we try to do is excellent. But when we tether it to the idea of excellence to this question about inclusion, it feels as if, particularly to those excluded, that there's a bit of a stereotype threat. Claude Steele's work on this is very powerful, around the feeling that inclusion could lower standards. Who wants to be the included one who's dragging a cloud of dust, who's making excellence somehow get foggy and invisible? So I say this because these are the contexts that shape how people might understand what's happening. They're good intentions, without a doubt, because we're saying, look, we're going to keep our standards and we're going to do inclusion, but it implies that somehow we otherwise wouldn't. And again, that's about how colorblind rhetoric works in this era. It's we're all inculcated with it. We're all really raised with it. So, you know, the open the doors spirit of inclusion and diversity has to be, on the one hand, open and open-hearted, without a doubt, but it has to confront the ways that systemic racism actually works. If it doesn't do that, it will actually be very difficult, and very, very difficult to achieve it. Now, you know, we're all not the first administrators, the first deans, set of deans, the first staff members, the first students, the first faculty members to try to have a diverse campus. People have been at this for 40-odd years. After the civil rights movement. That's not counting all that went on prior to that. So we should ask ourselves the hard question, well, why has it not really worked yet all that well? Why have the numbers stagnated? Not to criticize ourselves, but you can't solve a problem if you don't try to look at what people have tried to do and what they haven't been able to do despite their good intentions. We are fabulous. You all look terrific, but we are not the only people with good intentions. There's a lot of people who came before, and that has to involve a tremendous level of self-critique. The last third and most important thing to me is that you can't understand racism if you don't study it. This is about feelings, but it's also about knowledge. There's a whole body of literature. I would encourage you as faculty, as students, as staff, to expand the curriculum on these issues in every discipline. Disciplines, there's not really a single discipline, maybe the physical sciences, but nothing in the social sciences, nothing in the humanities, nothing in the arts is absent a cadre of scholars who work on questions of race, ethnicity, sexuality, difference, othering, marginality, power, et cetera. And yet, many campuses remain deeply uncomfortable with the study of that work and the study of those issues. We cannot confront this properly together and educate ourselves if we don't use our biggest weapon against it, which is our curriculum. That's what we're in here to do. We're here to teach, or at least that's what I was told I was here to do, you know, as a professor, write some books, but also to teach. And that means I have to be willing to put those questions and issues into the classroom as much as possible. It is risky, it is complicated, without a doubt. But if we don't actually study how it works, we undermine our students, and we actually undermine our efforts dramatically. And so, you know, in closing, I just want to say that, you know, this project, it couldn't be more timely and more important, because the end of the Obama era and the ushering in of the public awareness of a certain kind of violence to poor people across the board, really, but especially poor people of color, has really brought us with a very opportune moment. If we don't seize this moment, we don't seize what young people are particularly asking us, very politely, I would add, right now, really, right, to really take seriously. If we're not willing to do that, the question would really be when. You know, when is a good time? It just let me know, I'll mark my calendar. I've been here a while, I can wait. But let's pick that date and mean it. I mean, I'm saying this sarcastically because, of course, it never comes. The fierce urgency is of now. And that isn't to say that we don't study and don't reflect and don't have a long-range plan, because we need a long-range plan. But we have to be honest about what kind of work we really have to do and get as granular as possible and as visionary at the same time. In order to really make this happen, we want to make it stick. We don't want to be here. I doubt any of you want to be here 10 years from now and say, I was at the last meeting. Remember we said we were going to do this? What happened? Be like, I don't know. Right? I've been at enough schools that I've had that conversation with all the well-meaning people, myself included. Again, this is not about judgment. It's about sort of reflection about where we are. So we need open hearts and minds for sure. We need the dialogue that's going to happen. But we also need to have a certain kind of toughness. That is to say, we have to have thick skins about this. We have to keep going, right? It's not going to happen easily. The last two most important things are depersonalization. These are systems of power with ideas and ideologies. We're all implicated in different ways, but it's not personal. But it is collective. And that's extremely important for everyone, from my perspective, to keep in mind. And the curriculum on how structural racism actually works, how structural sexism, how class inequality works, is extremely important. And finally, we need courageous leadership at every level. I don't just mean the very top. We often look to the very top. It's crucial. Your president's committed. That kind of deep commitment matters. But actually, every level of leadership matters. That's why the students, that's why we owe them such a debt. Everything that you're doing really, really matters. And there's really no aspect of the institution, staff, faculty, groundsmen, it doesn't matter what the labor is, everybody has to participate in this dramatic change, because this is not for the faint of heart. This is not for the casual, engaged person. This is going to be the kind of change that requires all hands on deck and all hearts open. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Wendy. Thank you very much. I think we have about 10 minutes, 10 or 15 minutes, is that right? I'm happy to stand. I'm here all day, so I'm happy to chat all day. But for this conversation, I think I don't want to hold you guys back. So you think we have enough time for? Oh, great. Okay. And I really am happy to have really tough questions or grumpy questions. You know, I'm open to all comments, statements, proselytizing. Brother took me seriously. I have a different take than your president, so forgive me. I have a different point of view. I think it matters what we name our institutions. And I think that while there are definitely laudable characteristics of every Supreme Court justice to have ever graced the bench, right? They're well, they're distinguished. I mean, that's true of all of them, it would be my definition. I think that for the most part, he has stood largely against the expansion of the rights of many groups of people. For whatever his political reasons are, that's what the outcome of those positions would be. So I would be concerned about that naming. If it, you know, I would be concerned about it because I think it sends a signal. I mean, here you have. Let me give you a comparison. You remember when Princeton students were upset that the Woodrow Wilson School at Princeton was called the Woodrow Wilson School, and everyone said, "Oh, what's the big deal? Right? It doesn't matter." I was like, "Well, I'm not saying we should like scratch the man's name out, but it actually does really matter." Right? Well, what are we going to do? Everybody was racist back in 1919. You know, you can't, okay, that's a fair argument, but that's not true today. So now the question becomes, what are we carrying forward and what's the reason for this particular choice? This choice was not random any more than any other choice would be random. It has political consequences. That is to say, every choice has political consequences. Now, I don't know what they're going to be, but they have. They signal different traditions, they signal different intentions, and, you know, that will have to be grappled with. That's true for any institution. So from my vantage point, I would be disappointed if Brown were to have a law school and name it that. You know, as a person who works on what I work on, I would be concerned. So does that answer your question? Or, yeah, okay. Yeah, all right. So if people get through the process, and again, these are not meant to be understood only as hurdles, but as things for you all to keep your eye on as you develop plans and programs. You want to take that? Yeah, sure. As you develop ways of, you know, making sure that diversity sticks and that people get here and they stay here, as you work on those plans, these are just hurdles that I'm identifying so that many of you must already know, but in case you don't, it's something to help you think about. It's not meant to say they're hurdles, therefore can't happen. It's just to say, you know, if you know, you have to know what road you're getting on, right? If you're gonna go, if you need a four-wheel drive vehicle or not. The answer is you need a four-wheel drive vehicle for structural racism. So for mentorship and for promotion to tenure, it's very complicated. First of all, a few things that get in the way are, one, people often mentor people who they feel, and this happens with faculty members, even in terms of their graduate students. They want students that are going to do what they're doing. Academics are notoriously self-reflective. That's a very kind way of saying something not so kind. You know, we're like, you know, we want our students to study what we study, just do it a little bit better. Not that much better, but just a little bit better. You know, and so there's a lot of that kind of self-recognition. So if you don't have a diverse faculty already, whether it's gender, race, et cetera, you're very likely to find the mentorship gap to be significant. Very few departments have a cadre of people of color in them. So if you're not of color, if you're not black or Latino in particular, I'd like you to just imagine for a moment if you were in a space all day long that was 90% something else. And that the acknowledgement of the complexity of that really never really happens. So that's one thing, which is, what does it mean to not be mentored as fully because of this kind of unacknowledged recognition problem, which isn't intentional, but really about, again, the nature of how things can happen. The second thing is the invisible service work that women, faculty across the board, and faculty of color find themselves doing. When these students, the junior women of color at Brown faculty who, you know, were the main front lines faculty for the students who protested at Brown, they were exhausted. I looked at them, they had more pneumonia, they had everything. And so, you know, as a senior woman, my answer to that is, look, you cannot fix racism if you die, so go home, get some rest, and you cannot be the front lines. You have to get off the front lines and make somebody else do the work. But the problem is other people aren't really creating this atmosphere of connectivity, right, to the same degree, although they also get questions from the non-students of color who want to know, what's all this racism talk? So they got to answer everybody, right? That's a tremendous amount of mentorship, unmarked work, and then just the stress. And then there's how stereotype threat works in general. If you you know, are of color, and you have your typical junior issues with publishing and anxiety. We're all racked with guilt and terror and frustration, years 1 to 7. That's just human nature for the process. But when you add to that the fact that society as a whole is constantly saying that you're not actually as talented, that you're not actually as gifted, if you look at the research on this, it has a tremendous impact on performance for people who even have the identical skill. The same people perform worse when certain kinds of language is used. If you haven't read Claude Steele's work on this, I strongly recommend it. There's plenty of other research on it, but it's just an easy example. The book's called Whistling Vivaldi. So the stereotype threat happens at every rank, but it's especially important for junior faculty because they have a very hard line coming up. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. It's either you get here and you succeed or you don't. And that only makes the stress even greater. So the typical kind of freedom you might have to share your work when it's not ready, you know, is very hard to do. I've told many of my junior faculty, I run a center on race and ethnicity, so I invite junior faculty to come share their in-process work. I try to tell them, I promise we won't, you know, there'll be no judgment. They're paralyzed, a lot of them, and they're brilliant. But because the thought that someone might hear their unfinished, not yet perfected work, which would be all of our work forever, unfinished and non-perfect, I mean, couldn't you all rewrite your books all over again and say something like, be like, why didn't I say this, and why didn't I say that? You know, and who loves their work 10 years later? We're all wanting it to be perfect. Do you see my point? But junior people of color frequently find themselves much having to manage all of those kinds of conditions. There are many other factors, but those are a handful of the ones that come into play. So figuring out how to have really strong mentorship networks that work within discipline and across discipline. But again, climate change is about education about race, because I believe the vast majority of people would do something different if they understood the impact of what they're doing. I don't believe most people are sitting around saying, yeah, thank goodness, we're just keeping out the fill-in-the-blankers. You know, that's not what I believe is the case. But I think this lack of knowing and the comfort zone of familiar patterns and the acceptance of those patterns make it very hard to sort of promote that kind of a change that I think would make a very big difference and has when mentorship networks are very significant. Does that help answer your question? Yeah, that was a great, thank you for that. Yes.
So there are, so the structural violences, the structural racism that exists, mm-hmm. Require structural change, mm-hmm. which to me is policy change. Mm-hmm. So what are the policy changes that we should be working on to really address the structural impediments? Because
yeah.
most of our solutions, we focus on individuals, right?
Right.
Well, if you just manage your time better and
yeah.
seek out mentoring and
mm-hmm.
you know, say
nice
no
point.
And
yeah.
do yoga,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
these things, this is going to...
All good advice.
It's all going to make it easier. But
right.
But I look at, you know, the increasing number of publications that you need to get to tenure, or
uh-huh.
you look at like the thing we're going. To me, we're going in the opposite direction of
yeah.
inclusivity. So, what are the
this
structural
is great.
Changes?
Did someone say something else? No. Okay, that's a super great question. So, you know, there's lots of different potential policy changes that can be, you know, proposed or you know across the board because there's so many different areas to intervene. But let me just keep it sort of narrow on say higher education and our space that we're focusing on today. You know, I think, you know, it's extremely important to acknowledge that if there's a deep gap in the pipeline, then to extract an equal review of material from that unequal pipeline requires a specific kind of practice. It can't just be blindly, uninterrogatedly, you know, say, merit by itself, as if it's self-explanatory and as if everyone has a certain level of access. So we have to figure out very concrete practices that change, that actually create the conditions for a meritocracy. You see what I mean? So that's a very specific set of policies that the university can participate in and focus on. So for example, there have been a lot of studies and practices where you know you do students come in the first year and maybe their math isn't as they don't have the math skills that they're supposed to have yet coming out of unequal schools, so they have these kind of remedial programs. Kids hate them, they don't do well in them. If you have aspirational programs, they do great. The same kids right? I mean, the studies are that it's not that the kids are smart. All the kids are smart. I tell the first years when they come to Brown of color, look, there's not one of you that is not brilliant. Let's just get this clarified. It's like 50,000 people tried to get in here. Okay, you're all set on the brains part. Okay, so now we got to work on your confidence about what you think you're supposed to be able to do. Right? Now that's about partly creating social structures and conditions, right? Whether they're mentorship groups, whether they're junior, senior faculty, seniors, juniors and seniors who've been mentored into whatever the field and discipline is, helping first years feel a certain kind of confidence that are institutionally supported. Another opportunity is to not treat diversity as something that, again, either interferes with or is sort of separate from the general business of the university. That's hard to do, but it's very important. So thinking about just how you will create that diversity is as equally important. If I'm in the French department, I'm just randomly picking this, so nothing personal, I love French. I love French everything. Maybe that's why I said it. So I'm in the French department, say, and I want to hire someone who focuses on, you know, I don't know, Renaissance or Baroque art or something in France. And I'm the chair, and this is what we want in the department. But I find out that, you know, actually, you know, diversity is an agenda, right? And I find out that there are many people of color who deal with, say, colonial French issues, but they don't deal with the issue of the field that I was just about to hire in. So if diversity is equally important, then I have an obligation to ask the department to think seriously about the fact that we keep growing in areas where there are no people of color. Where if I go over here, they all speak French, they're dealing with the French Empire, they're dealing with, you know, some French, and there's a whole gaggle of excellent people right over here. But I'm still gonna keep looking over here. That means diversity is a subset of my privilege to decide what we ought to be studying, right? And that has to be policed out at the administration level. That is to say, no, look, you have to have not only a plan, but a way to implement it. Doesn't mean that's all you're going to hire in. I didn't say this is all you're going to hire in. I have to warn people because they get all worked up. What are we going to do? We're going to be a French colonial department. No, just you make sure if you want, you know, more women's historians, I mean, if you want more women who are historians, you will find 10 times the number if you actually study women's history in the department. It's really not that hard. And that's another political issue, but I'm not going to go there. But this is important because we like this illusion. Remember, this is why colorblindness is so stressful, because it makes you think that if you're in a meeting and someone says, well, I just think it's absolutely essential that we study this as a subset of our, you know, field, when, of course, you can't study everything. Very few departments are as big as everything in their field would require. And yet, you want to say, well, wait a minute, we'll do a lot better with diversity if we hire over here. You know, it takes a lot of courage to say that and to press a department into seeing diversity as an equally significant component of their growth as well as field investments. We need someone who does ancient so-and-so. They left. Okay, they left. That doesn't mean the field has to be the same. We have this in my department all the time in a variety of ways. So it's about recognizing where the strengths are. Now, I had this debate. I'll just give you this a very interesting thing. I had this debate with a colleague recently, and he said, well, look, I hear what you're saying. I won't say his field, but he was in a social science field, and he said, I hear what you're saying, but, you know, the studying race is not considered the top subfields of the discipline. I said, okay, well, you have to change that. I mean, that's like a chase your tail argument. So we can't hire any people, if you say to me, Tricia, there's more people of color who study race in whatever it is, social science field, say, but if we study race, we'll drop in ranking, and therefore we can't hire anybody of color. So basically you've just set up a world in which we must support it. That's why it has to be courageous. It has to say, we're gonna build a new model. We're not going to follow status quo, because status quo is how we got here. That's how we got here. So those would be, thank you. Those are some ways I would, you know, sort of brass tacks educational policy within a given institution, you know, might help. It's got to be all layers, right? It's like this, you know, it's not going to be, you know, it's that's my political theater. It's not going to work like that. It's really going to have to be some kind of thing. Unless, well, it can work other ways, but the most stabilizing way is the way I'm arguing for there. That's a great question. Thank you. I think we have time for one or two more, I think. One more? No more?
No, sorry.
Not even one? Oh, I so love talking. What about one? All right, one, and I promise to give a two-sentence answer. Okay, yes.
So you're saying there's 0.3% black women who have their PhDs.
Mm-hmm.
So are you then recommending that more black women pursue PhDs, even though there are obstacles put in place?
There are obstacles for black women to get any degree doing anything. So yes. And I promised a short answer, and it was true. Thank you all so much. I really, really appreciate it.